That's some really good shit.
Hey, do you think I can get ahead of that? Never seen a talking fucking teddy bear before?
I guess we'll just do the review in here.
Lazy, my thoughts are hazy, but this is one thing I'm sure of. Everybody needs a best friend. I'm happy I'm yours. You got a double.
Hey guys, Adam here, and welcome to another On the Couch Rewind. Or, in this case, on the bed, since, that is out there and I don't want to be near it. So Ted finally got around to watching this. Seth MacFarlane's directorial debut. I fucking love it. I fucking love this movie. This movie's hilarious. If anything, it's one of the best comedies I've seen in a long time. And I've seen a few, but nothing that but it's very rare these days to find a good comedy. Like a really good comedy. And Ted's one of them. Ted is one of those comedies that I just lapped my ass off at. Alright, so the plot is John Bennett is a Boston kid who one day gets a teddy bear for Christmas. He wishes it will come to life, and thus Ted is born. So John and Ted become best friends for life, or thunder buddies for life, and then fast forwards to years later. John has a girlfriend. Ted is kind of a menace to society in a way, and it just chronicles how John needs to move on with his life, even though his best friend is a teddy bear and whatnot. That's the plot. I mean, it's a very simple plot. And it's funny. This movie is fucking hilarious. It really is. I mean, I like Seth MacFarlane to begin with. I think he's a very talented guy. He knows how to do comedy. He really does. I did like Family Guy early on. Like years ago when it was funny. Cleveland Show, American Dad, that's actually my favorite of the three is American Dad. Now I never saw A Million Ways to Die in West, although I heard it's not very good, but that's not what I'm going to talk about. Ted's funny. Ted's great. I'm not worried about spoiling it because by this point everyone else has seen it. I just saw it. The cast. Mark Wahlberg as John Bennett. It's Mark Wahlberg. I fucking love Mark Wahlberg. Mark Wahlberg. I kind of realize I'm like Mark Wahlberg in a way. I am. minus the arms. Because Mark Wahlberg has arms, like fucking arms. Jesus Christ, he has arms. But I don't know, like this character, I'm very much like Mark Wahlberg. I'm kind of a slacker. I'm a man child to a nth degree. I am. And I think I can dance. I'm under the delusional I can dance and girls like me dancing. There was a scene there where they flash back to when John and Lori, Mila Kunis' character, meet, and he's just dancing, you know, like 90s dance and whatnot, because he's Marky Mark, and he accidentally hits Mila Kunis in the head, and she's just, oh, that's not dancing. Oh, you mean the day, that night when you were, like, fake dancing or whatever? He goes, oh, that's not how I remember it. And then it cuts to him dancing, like, awesome to Bee Gees, which was a spoof of Airplane. And that was funny. Mila Kunis plays Lori, who is this girl who loves John, really does, but really is tired of him just being immature and irresponsible and whatnot because his best friend's a teddy bear. She feels like he needs to move on from just always hanging out with Ted so their relationship can move further along. And she's a good character. I mean, whether you like Mila Kunis or not, she's a good character. She is. I liked her in this. She wasn't unbearable to watch with this character where she was like, because I kind of get what she was coming from. She really didn't want, she felt like Ted was being a bad influence, which he is. He is a horrible influence on John. Like, John's a nice guy. John's a pure soul, in a way. But Ted's a horrible influence on him. Ted, the star, played by Seth MacFarlane, is the highlight of this movie. He's fucking awesome. He is. He's amazing. He's just, I mean, great. And yes, he sounds like Peter Griffin, and they make a joke about that. And like I said, Ted's a horrible influence, but he's likable. He is. It's very evident he gives a shit about John. He gives a shit about Lori. He's a horrible influence, but he does care. He's a good person. He is, in a way, a good person because he values John as his best friend. They are best friends. And he just comes up, and he comes up with the funniest shit in this movie. It's like, every line he says is goddamn hilarious. Like, I cracked up so hard every time he said something that is funny. Like, for instance, there was a scene, this is my favorite scene. There's a scene, Ted meets the new cashier girl after he gets a job. And he really likes her. So one day, he's in the back, and so because he's in the back, one day the manager realizes there's only one register open. He goes to the back and sees Ted having sex with a cashier girl. And then it cuts to Ted and Ted and the manager, and the manager's like, I just saw you have sex with a cashier girl on top of the produce, which we sell to our customers. And Ted says, yeah, well, last week I fucked her with a posh nip and sold it to a family with four small children. And, I mean, I like vulgarity in my movies. I do. I actually do. And, which is why I kind of like Sabotage as well. But then the manager says, you got guts. I'm promoting you. You got some fucking issues, you know that? One of my other scenes was earlier when he interviews for a job, not wanting the job at all, so he does everything he can not to get the job, and he goes like, "It's like, so why should I hire you?" It's like, because I fucked your wife, because I fucked your wife Ryan the Pussy, and everyone else likes our fucking box. And the manager's like, no one's ever talked to me like that. You're hired. Shit. Ah, shit. I mean, Ted's a great character. Ted's not just like a MacGuffin for jokes and one-liners. He is a full-fledged character. He's an enjoyable character. He's great. And then you got some of the cameos. Like, you got Norah Jones in this movie who knows Ted, and it's implied that they fucked. They even make a joke about how hard that would be since he doesn't have a dick. And that was funny. And I love Norah Jones. I enjoy Norah Jones's music. Like, she's really good. She has a beautiful voice. And Here it proves she has great comedic timing, too. Especially when she's mostly talking to a teddy bear. Which I'm sure wasn't there to begin with. Let's see, who else? Sam Jones from Flash Gordon. Flash Gordon himself. Like, he's in this as himself, a drugged out motherfucking version of himself, who is also the childhood hero of Ted and John. So when they show him, they start playing the theme song to Ted. And it's awesome. Because then it cuts to Sam Jones wearing his Flash Gordon costume. And then as the song continues to play, and then it cuts to a daydream of John and Sam flying on Mongo, on the planet Mongo, and just having a fantasy dream of what it's like to fly with Flash Gordon. And then it cuts to like Sam Jones, coked out of his motherfucking mind, punches a hole in the wall, and then has to fight Ted's Asian neighbor, whose name is Ming. And so because Sam is hot, is like coked out of his goddamn mind, he's imagining this Asian guy who is holding a wooden spoon and a duck, which Ted fights and loses against. And the dude is dressed up like Ming the Merciless from Flash Gordon. And so Sam Jones goes, "Death to me!" and starts fighting the Asian neighbor. I mean, it's fucking great. I mean, I love this goddamn movie. And then you have Giovanni Ribisi as the villain, named Donnie. How do I put this delicately? Giovanni Ribisi is fucking creepy in this movie! He is goddamn insane! Like, I'm talking Buffalo fucking Bill levels of fucking creepy in this! Like, I'm pretty sure he killed some people! Like, in the movie, he wanted to buy Ted because his dad told him no. When he was a kid, he asked his dad to buy him a talking teddy bear like Ted, and his dad said no. So he vowed to never tell his son no, ever. And so he has this spoiled, fat little shit of a son, but pretty sure that Donnie is one, but it's very evident Donnie wanted it for himself as well. And like I said, he is Buffalo Bill levels of fucking creepy. So the only thing, so yeah, he starts dancing and he's dancing to Tiffany. But I'm surprised he didn't do it naked with his balls and dick tucked between his goddamn legs. Because that's, granted, I think I would have felt more comfortable with that than him drinking out of a cup with a straw. Just like, because, I mean, I like Giovanni Ribisi. Giovanni Ribisi is a great actor. He really is. He's enjoyably fun. He is fucking uncomfortable in this goddamn movie. I was creeped the fuck out in this movie. Oh my god. Ugh. Giovanni Ribisi. But yeah. And one thing I really admire about this movie is the special effects on Ted. Ted looks really good. You can believe he is in this movie. You believe this is a real teddy bear. You do. As you know, from people who watch Family Guy or any of Seth MacFarlane's shows, he likes to do cutaway gags, which this movie does, but not often. They're actually very rare. And when they do it, it's not something fucking random like on Family Guy, movie reference or anything. It's kind of, it's like a cutaway to a previous event that involves the characters. That is the, that's, and it works. It makes sense, and it makes it funny. Like, for instance, there was a scene where Mila Kunis and John are getting back from their anniversary dinner. And Mila Kunis is the first one to walk in and notices and sees Ted with four prostitutes. And she gets a little upset, but then she turns around and goes, is that a shit? Is that a shit on my floor? There's a shit on my floor! And Ted says, like, oh yeah, we were playing Truth or Dare, and Cassidy here, she's pretty ballsy. And then it cuts, and then later it talks about the shit, they talk about the shit again, and then it cuts to Mila Kunis trying to pick up the shit. And John is like hiding behind this pillar because he's scared of the shit, which I completely understand. I have cleaned not just dog shit. Okay, dog shit is fine because that shit dries up easily, but fucking human shit, having to clean human shit, that is where I draw the fucking line. Oh my god. And Mila Kunis is like, it's on my thumb! It's on my thumb! Oh my god! Oh, get away from me! It's one of those moments where I'm just like, I totally get these people. I totally understand why they would be mad at Ted for allowing a hooker to shit on their floor. Oh god. I mean, It's that great. And also the chemistry between Mark Wahlberg and Mila Kunis is very genuine. Like, they're really good together. They look really good together. Granted, it did take me a while to, like, really buy into Mila Kunis and Mark Wahlberg being within the same age. Because Mark Wahlberg in real life is, like, 44. But in this movie, he's 35. And, I mean, it looks great for 44, but whatever. But Mila Kunis is like, I think she was like in her mid to late 20s at this time. But you know what? You kind of buy it after a while. You do. But you can tell these two love each other that, and all that. And, Joel McHale is in this too, playing Joel McHale being an asshole. That's about it. That's what he does. And he's also a Laurie stalker, like he's trying to sleep with her, even though he's well aware that she is dating someone, especially Mark Wahlberg, who has big fucking arms and can probably beat the shit out of Joel McHale. And we're not talking Deliver Us From Evil Joel McHale, where I'm pretty sure both he and Mark Wahlberg are equally matched. I'm talking, like, the soup Joel McHale versus Mark Wahlberg. Because that is how big Mark Wahlberg is. So, yeah, one of the other things about this movie is, there's one other cameo, is this joke about Tom Skerritt. Like, even Joel McHale and Mark Wahlberg's boss are like, oh yeah, I know Tom Skerritt. Here's me with Tom Skerritt. This could be you one day. And then at the end of the movie, John and Laurie have just gotten married, are getting married, and John's boss is there. And he's with Tom Skerritt. And his boss is like, it's Tom Skerritt. And John goes, Tom fucking Skerritt. Awesome. And then the boss is like, thanks for coming here, Tom. Tom Skerritt just like, my daughter better still be alive, you son of a bitch. It's just one of those things where I just kind of fucking laughed. It's because, like, it's something that Seth MacFarlane would have done, would have put in that movie, but it's also kind of genuine. It's a good payoff. It's a good payoff to find out that Tom Skerritt doesn't want to be with this guy. Obviously, like, yeah, no, like, it's very evident this guy just happened to take a picture with Tom Skerritt, and they're not really friends. Again, I can kind of understand that. It's, so yeah, and like I said, these jokes are funny. These jokes are genuine. They're not all the way over the top, and they're not fucking. They're not all gross out humor. I mean, yeah, there's gross out humor. What the fuck do you expect? But it works. It's realistic in a way, especially a movie about a talking fucking teddy bear. So yeah, that's about it. That's all I want to talk about. Final score for Ted is an 8 out of 10. I enjoyed this movie. I really do. It's not my favorite comedy, but it's among some of the best comedies I've seen in a long time. So yeah, that's about it. I will see you guys next time when I review Ted 2. Until then, I will see you guys later, and maybe that thing is gone now.
Hey, yeah, I was just wondering if you wanted to finish some of this weed up, because there's some cops outside, and I think they may be looking. I was just wondering if you want to go ahead and get rid of it so they won't know, all right? Because hiding it's not going to do any good.
Man, it's really hard. This was really nice, Ted. You're not so bad after all. Friends? Good. Thunder buddies for life?
You're damn fucking right!
When you hear the sound of thunder, don't you get too scared. Just grab your thunder buddy and say these magic words. Fuck you, thunder! You can suck my dick. You can't get me, thunder, cause you're just God's farts.